Part 5 in quality project management is about Six Sigma. It's a process that makes use of statistics and data analysis to analyze and reduce errors or defects. In this process, the purpose is to improve cycle time while reducing manufacturing defects to no more than 3.5 defects per million units or events. So sigma, it's a statistical concept that represents how much variation there is in a process related to customer specification. And the value of sigma is based on defects per million opportunities or DPMO, and Six Sigma, which is equivalent to 3.4 defects per million operations or opportunities. The variations in the process is so small that the resulting products and service are 99.99966 defects free. Six Sigma is a quality management methodology used to help business to improve current process, products or service by discovering and eliminating defects. The goal is to streamline quality control in manufacturing or business process so there is little to no variance throughout. So the amount of variation, like too much, moderate, and very little. If it is too much, the effect is hard to produce output within customer specification. The sigma value is low, 0 to 2. For moderate, most output meets customer specifications. So sigma value is middle, 3 to 5. And very little variation, that means virtually all output meets customer specifications, and the sigma value is higher. So the development of Six Sigma. It was in the early 1980s. Bill Smith at Motorola developed Six Sigma principles in order to measure defects and improve the overall quality. The original idea still forms the core of Six Sigma methodologies with a few more additions, which includes improving process with regards to the interactions and product design. Bill Smith was working with Motorola at the time and needed a quality management tool to increase the business performance. He set about developing the method and spent all of his energy on what would be the future of quality management. Six Sigma replaced total quality management and business process re-engineering as a key strategy for quality improvement. So as a short summary, in 1970s, Motorola actually, Bill Smith, who considered as the father of Six Sigma, introduced the quality management methodology to Motorola because of the criticism of bad quality by Al Suntray, the senior executive of Motorola. Sigma means standard deviation. It's a measure of variability. Six Sigma It's a quality improvement philosophy that focuses on eliminating defects through a reduction of variations in a process. And defects means it's a measurable outcome that is not within acceptable limits or specification limits. Six Sigma, it's a method that provides organizations tools to improve the capability of their business process. This increase in performance and decrease in process variation helps lead to reduction and improvement in product, in profits, employee morale, and quality of products and services. So there are two proverbs for Six Sigma: evolving process to achieve better quality and delivering tomorrow's progress or performance by today. There are two approaches they are having, that is scientific method and practical method. In scientific method means it's a structural approach and assuming quantitative data results show the data. And practical approach, financial emphasis on financial result, start with the voice of the customer, and as a result, it means show me the money. Comparison between TQM, Total Quality Management, and Six Sigma. Total Quality Management defines quality as a process to meet the standards established by the organization, whereas Six Sigma defines it as the process with the minimum amount of defects. So TQM, a management philosophy of quality improvement, whereas Six Sigma, a philosophy that focuses on defect reduction and cost reduction. Encourage involvements of all employees, depends on selected groups of highly trained employees. And in TQM, senior management provides direct support. And in Six Sigma, senior management is held accountable for the result because they are selecting only a small group of highly trained employees. Since TQM defines quality as a process meeting the standards established by the organization, this is the reason why TQM delivers super quality manufacturing goods while Six Sigma delivers better result and customer satisfaction. The success factors of Six Sigma, like shared change purpose, effective change leadership, a powerful engagement process, committed local sponsors, strong personal connections, sustainable personal performance, training, bottom line orientation and continuous reinforcement and rewards, etc. The formulas: defect per unit equal to number of defects discovered divided by number of units produced. Defects per million opportunities equal to number of defects discovered divided by opportunities of error, for opportunities for error into 10 lakhs. Defects rate process capability index CP equal to upper specification limit minus lower specification limit divided by Six Sigma. And estimating the process capability index from a sample CPK equal to the minimum of UCL minus X bar, that is average outcome from a sample, by 3S, need stands for standard deviation from a sample, comma X bar minus lower specification limit by 3S. Okay, an example of this Six Sigma, so finding the defects or finding defects per million opportunities or defect rate process capability index or estimating process capability index from a sample. So all these will be discussed in another video that will be uploaded soon in my YouTube channel. So where we can apply the Six Sigma? Sigma can be applied anywhere in the organization. It may be from production, it may be in design, it may be in service, in purchase, in human resource management, in administration, in quality deployment or quality department, management, marketing and sales, as well as IT. That means every part of the organizations can be implemented with the help of Six Sigma to improve the quality or for quality improvement. The companies generally used are like Motorola, General Electronic, Citibank, Sony, Ericsson, and Ford. The Six Sigma methodology. So on statement is there. If you implement Six Sigma in your organization, it takes money to earn money or to save money. So there are generally three different methodology used. But in officially, we can able to find the DMIC and DMADV. The BPMS is not been much popular, but actually it's also one of the best methodology used for Six Sigma. That is the business process management system, DMAIC, that is define, measure, analyze, improve, and control, and DMADV, define, measure, analyze, design, and verify. The first one, that is BPM project framework. So the BPM system enables the modeling, design, execution, and maintenance of business activities and the employees who manage them across different departments and physical locations. So starting from the fundamental, so it contains 4F, that is why it is called 7FE, that is 4F and 3E, essential, essential, essential. The 4F like foundations, findings and solutions, fulfillment, future, and essential like leadership, project management, and people change management. So the foundations like organizational strategy and process architecture. So this organizational strategy includes the organizational strategy like vision, strategic goals, business, and executive drivers are clearly understood by the project team members. The stakeholders expect short or long-term gains from this project. Second is process architecture. The process architecture is the means by which the organizations establish a set of rules, principles, guidelines, and models for the implementation of the BPM across the organization. Third is the launchpad phase. It contains three major outcomes: the selection of where to start the initial BPM project within the organization, agreement on the process goals under vision once the process has been selected, and third one is establishment of the selected projects. Then comes the understand phase. This phase is all about understanding enough of the current business process environment to enable the innovate phase to take place. It is essential that at least basic process metrics are gathered to allow for the establishment of process baseline cost for future comparative purposes. Then comes the innovative phase. This is a creative phase of this project and often the most interesting. It should not only involve the project teams and the business, but also relevant stakeholders, both internal and external. Then develop. This phase consists of building all the components for the implementation of the new process. It is important to understand the build in this context does not necessarily mean that an IT build. It could involve the building of all infrastructure. Then comes the people. So the critical phase of the framework, and it could put the rest of the project at risk if not handled thoroughly and to high standards. The purpose of this phase is to ensure that the activities, roles, and performance measurements match the organization's strategy and process goals. At the end of the day, it is the people that will make the process function effectively and efficiently, no matter how much automation is involved, but people involvement is always there. Then comes the implement phase. This is the phase where the rubber hit the road. That is, it is where all the aspects of the project take place. The implementation plans are crucial, or the rollback and the contingency plans. Many organizations believe that the project has been completed after implementation has been successful. But the next two phases, that is the realized value and sustainable performance, are more important. So realized value, the next two phase, the purpose of this phase is to ensure that the benefits, outcomes outlined in the project business case are realized. This phase basically comprises the delivery of the benefits realization management process and benefit realization reporting. Unless the benefits are realized, the organization should not provide additional funding to continue further process projects. Then comes finally the sustainable performance. So it is absolutely essential that the project team works with the business to establish a process structure to ensure that continued process agility and improvements are sustainable. And the essentials like project management. Clients often ask, can a normal applications or business project manager implement a BPM project? The answer is a qualified yes, but nowhere near as well as an experienced BPM project manager. Then people change management. We will look at the importance of the change process as it specifically relates to the implementation of the personal aspects of a BPM project. Then comes leadership. The people's commitment to change matters more than the details of the plan for plan for change. The extent to which executive leaders delegate responsibility is crucial to the effectiveness of the outcome of BPM projects. So the 7FE stands for the foundations to set up for the success. BPM projects need a solid underpinning. They have to be rooted in the organization approximately, and the launchpad phase is designed to validate these aspects. then findings and solutions, relate to understanding of existing process, and how to go about identifying suitable solutions in the innovate phase. Then comes fulfillment. The third one is how the people and develop come together to fulfill the need. Especially, this is a combination of best practices in organizational design and the role of the BPMS in project implementation. Then finally, future relates how the organization realizes the value and deliver ongoing sustainable performance. So essentials of process leadership, BPM project management, and people change management are vital throughout the entire project. So the three essentials and four foundations, finding and solutions, fulfillment, and future constitute this 7FE, this 7FE framework. 7FE, that stands for that. One is the future, second one is fulfillment, third one is finding, fourth one is foundations. So 4F, and essential was first E, then second E, and third E. That is 3E and 4F stands for that 7FE framework. Okay. Then comes DMAIC and DMADV. So DMAIC addresses the current process, where DMADV addresses the design process. And DMAIC eliminates defects, whereas DMADV prevents defects, that is proactive. And the DMAIC is reactive. DMAIC includes specific solutions, whereas DMADV is part of the solution design process. So what is it, DMAIC phases? It's an acronym that stands for define, measure, analyze, improve, and control. It represents the five phases that makes up the process: define the problem, improve activity, opportunity for improvements, the project goals and customer internal and external, and requirements. That is, define specific goals, measure reduction of defects, analyze the problem, cause and effects must be considered, improve process on basis of measurements and analysis, and control process to minimize the defects. Whereas that of DMADV, define, measure, analyze, design, validate, aims to redesign a problematic process or products. The approach initially follows the first three steps of DMAIC, that is define, measure, and analysis, and then deviates in the last two steps by introducing design or redesign and validate steps to gain the improvement needed. So in short, we can tell DMAIC addresses the current process, whereas that of DMADV addresses the design process. So when we can use DMA? When we can use Six Sigma? So the uses depends on the type of the business. That is, if there are processes that generate a lot of variations or negative customer feedback, whether the customer belongs to the organizations or external, the components of Six Sigma should be considered as the means of study and rectify the problem. That is, whenever we are getting a negative customer feedback, at that time we can think about Six Sigma. And the benefits of Six Sigma, generate sustained success, sets performance goals for everyone, enhances value for customers, accelerate rate of improvements, promotes learning across boundaries, executes strategic changes. Or in other words, we can tell Six Sigma, once if we implemented the Six Sigma, the company can, for example, for that is General Electronics, which we are mentioning, like increased productivity, improved quality, reduced operation cost, higher customer satisfaction, improved communication among team members. So these are about the benefits of Six Sigma. Then comes the key roles of Six Sigma, like yellow, green, black, master black belt, champion, and executives. So starting, so it's a detailed and disciplined methodology for improving process in many aspects of business management while boosting leadership skills, saving time, and promoting cost efficiency for managers. So the first one, that is about yellow belt. So this certification signifies an understanding of the basic metrics and improvement methods for Six Sigma, plus the ability to integrate these tactics into the organization's production systems. So their role in the Six Sigma process is that it's of a core member. That means a professional who works on the project, awareness of Six Sigma. There is no training. Anyone can be a yellow belt certified. Second one is green belt, are often part-time professional with a variety of duties, which includes assisting on black belt projects and leading smaller projects. They are trained in problem solving techniques and the tenets of the DMAIC project model. When involved in black belt projects, their duties include gathering data, executing experiments, and analyzing information. Then comes the black belt. We can consider them as the team leader for the Six Sigma projects. They are full-time professionals whose main responsibility is to be a team leader for Six Sigma projects. The Six Sigma Academy states that black belts have the ability to save business estimation around $230,000 on each project they lead, and they can complete 4 to 6 projects a year. Then comes the master black belt, considered as the expert. So they are the experts in the methodology, resources, and practices of Six Sigma. The main objective of the MBB, that is master black belt, is to coach and train the black belts using their advanced skills in problem solving, leadership, resource management, and project deployment. They work hand in hand with the Six Sigma leaders to make sure that company initiatives stay on track. So master black belt also have the ability to train and certify others in the methods of Six Sigma. Then comes the champion, working in conjunction with the conjunction executives. The Six Sigma champions assumes a critical role at the senior or middle executive level. It's the duty of the champion to understand the details and maintains the company moral, such as its vision, mission, and metrics, and use this information to tailor the Six Sigma plan to fit the corporation's goals. And then finally, the executives, they represent the most senior level leadership within the Six Sigma hierarchy with the most training and experience. Executives are best equipped with the leadership skills to establish strategies and to focus the Six Sigma program in accordance with the organization's specific culture and goal. Criticisms. Because Six Sigma is applied to all aspects of production and planning process, it may create a rigidity and bureaucracy that can create delays and and in creativity. In addition, its customer focus may be taken to extremes, where internal quality control measures that make sense for a company are not taken because of the overlying goal of achieving the Six Sigma stipulated level of consumer satisfaction. See, for example, an inexpensive measure that carries a risk of a slightly higher defect rate may be rejected in favor of a more expensive measure that helps to achieve Six Sigma, but adversely affects the profitability. So Six Sigma is, another one is Six Sigma is extremely costly for many small businesses to implement, because employees must obtain training from certified Six Sigma institutes in order for an enterprise to receive Six Sigma certification. Even if a firm wishes to implement Six Sigma without formal certification, much training is necessary in order to understand the system and how to apply it to particular business process. Many small businesses cannot possibly afford such training because, as an example, for a master black belt, the cost of training is at least $17,000. That's all this session.